Cisco, your co-host for today's sixth edition of the UAE Workshop Series. With me, I have the man of the hour, Mr. Warren Tuttle. Warren, what's going on, my friend?
Hi, Carmine. Everything's great. How are you doing?
I'm doing good, doing good. I was just a little messed up there trying to go live to YouTube and record and just getting a little crazy. How you doing? What's happening?
Hey, are you ready for Memorial Day weekend? I can't believe it's here already.
I know. Well, you know, we're stuck in the house for 2 months or more, and all of a sudden we come out and we got a holiday to go to.
Yeah. The weather's great up in Connecticut. Although I hear it's raining all over the country, so I've heard a lot of reports of rain. But everything's good. We've had some good things going on with the UIA with this series. This is week six of our UIA educational series. Every week, folks, at the same time, 2 o'clock Eastern on Thursdays. Today we have a great show, which we'll introduce in a second, but we've covered everything from social media and PR to United States Patent and Trademark Office to all types of great, great, great venues. And we've got a couple of good ones coming up before we end the show at the end of June. So thanks everybody for listening in.
Yeah. What's up real quick? You got any info on the hardware show?
So as far as I know, it's still scheduled for first, second, and third of September. You know, I got a refund on my rooms in May, and I rebooked, and they're taking money. So I know MGM is in business. I don't know what this all means yet. We'll probably know in a few weeks. I would say by mid-June, we'll have an idea of what's going on. We'll keep you abreast. Right now, it's a go, but, you know, we're not sure, you know, so we'll find out.
Okay, cool. Well, I know we got some great guests on today. This is we already got a whole bunch of people watching on YouTube, but it must be because of the guests.
Well, this is exciting. So just so you know, next week, a week from today, we're going to do patent law with Jim Patterson, Andrea Hens-Evans. And then the week after that, we're going to get into inventor coaching. We're going to have a couple of individual coaches, David Fedewa, along with Jim DeBetta. So that's coming up. Everybody who's on our shows are either UIA board members or UIA ambassadors. So this is all UIA program for everybody, United Inventors Association. So without further ado, though, let me introduce our guests. We've got two phenomenal guests today. Really, really comes to mind for a long time. We have from Minnesota, we've got Trevor Lambert, who will introduce himself in a second. And we from New York, we have Mark Portney. And what we'd love you guys to do, maybe Trevor, go first. Say hi, take a couple minutes. Tell us how you got into your business and what you're up to. And then we'll get into some fun questions. So Trevor, I turn it over to you. Welcome.
Hey, thanks guys for having me. Like you said, my name is Trevor Lambert. I got in the invention industry about 20 years ago now, and it was kind of started with my own inventing. And I was just, I had a construction business and I was building handcrafted log homes. So I was running a chainsaw all day and I was starting to come up with invention ideas. And then I eventually fell in love with one or two of them and started kind of going down the process. And over the course of that year, I just really got interested in the whole process of licensing products to larger companies to make royalties. And so about 6 months later, I founded Lambert Licensing. And the way that we work at Lambert Licensing is we work on contingency. So we kind of pick items that we really like, and then we represent them at no further charge to the inventors for our services of the actual marketing program and trying to seek a license deal. Over the course of the years, it became evident we really needed to have product development, because a lot of times we were taking on products that were, you know, earlier stages. And so we were spending a lot of money on industrial design and engineering. And so in 2009, I founded a design firm called Enhanced Product Development. So totally, I have about 15 team members here in Minneapolis. So
that's awesome, guys. And yeah, Trevor's been in the business for quite a while. And he's learned a lot, and we're going to get into some of those things. So we'll get back to you in a second. But Mark Portney, say hi, and do, if you could do the same thing as Trevor, it'd be great.
Sure, it's not going to be as sexy, but I'll do it. my name's Mark Portney. I'm not smart enough to be an inventor, so I have to rely on inventors. I was the host of a show on Discovery Science Channel called All American Makers. And I was one of the all-star entrepreneurs on the HSN American Dreams program. I own a few companies, and one of the companies is an e-commerce and distribution company. The other company is Global Source Infrastructure Partners, where we do a lot of importing, et cetera. But A lot of people say this, but we take things from a prototype all the way through to store shelves or on shopping television and everything in between. So I have manufacturing contacts all over the world, and we take products and we absolutely blow them up into monster items. So like Trevor, I'm also very picky because I don't charge. Either we make money together or we don't make money at all. And I have to be very careful because everything is basically by the deal. So if I take something on and I'm not charging, all of a sudden, if it's a flop, we flop together. So I'm pretty picky, like Trevor intimated.
Cool. So listen, and you know, I have a fair amount of experience, obviously, in licensing as well. So this will be a fun conversation to monitor. But so just so everybody knows who's watching, we all three of us feel pretty strongly, very strongly. We know we have a lot of knowledge in the licensing area, and we all feel very strongly about not charging folks. We're not coaches who charge money and take your money. We're also part of the United Mentors Association, which is a nonprofit. So we're here, and if you want to follow up with us later with questions and emails and so forth, get in touch with us. By the way, my email is www.tuttle@yahoo.com, and I'll let Trevor and Mark give theirs as well. But so we're coming at this thing not as marketers, we're coming at this as, in some cases, end users, partnerships, and investing in products. So we take kind of a hard line on what we're looking for and what we think companies are looking for. So with that background, Trevor, let me start with you. You and I have talked a lot over the years about prototypes and intellectual property, sort of being entry points to licensing and so forth. Maybe give us your opinions on how that matters and how it matters in the licensing arena.
In terms of how developed the product is?
Yeah, how developed the product is. I mean, I listened to a seminar last week where they said you could take some on a napkin, sketch and throw it. I'm not familiar with that process. I've never seen one license.
I have heard some folks online talk about how they can, you know, a napkin sketch and they can license that. And I've not been able to do that. I mean, typically if you approach a company for licensing with something like that, you're just not taken seriously. I mean, you know, and that's like I mentioned, the whole reason why we developed enhanced product development and founded a new company and really grew out the infrastructure of product development is for that very reason. Because I mean, the reality is you're what you have to license, you know, you have to get their attention. You know what I mean? And if you have a napkin sketch, it's just an idea. Again, you're just, nobody is really interested.
Well, tell me if you had a napkin sketch and it's just an idea, what exactly is it that you're licensing? Maybe we can go at it from that way and work our way backwards.
The napkin.
Well, you know, I heard someone say, I didn't make this up, but it was an idea is worth like 0.875 cents or something like that. You know, a dime a dozen. And so that's the whole thing, is that you really have to flesh it out and you have to develop it so that when you come to them, that you can show the due diligence that was done, not only just in the product development, but also on the intellectual property side for the patent. You know, you go through the patent search and maybe you start the provisional, whatever, utility design, whatever it might be. That's what ultimately you're licensing.
Now, with Enhance, because obviously you've gotten into that a lot. I mean, those two things work hand in hand, right? Developing the product, developing the prototype, and then coming up with your claims for patents. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the product development, you know, we don't file utility patents until we have a product fairly developed. I mean, we'll file a provisional in the process, but like a lot of times you don't know where it's going to take you, you know, when you're developing the product. And so you kind of want to make sure that your final patent actually covers the product that is going to go to market. And so, you know, you got to stay within the scope of the provisional, and I'll let the patent attorneys discuss that. But you know, just for our purposes, we want what is going to go to market to be actually protected.
Now, what is your definition of product development? You know, what an actual prototype, CADs, tell us what that means to you, product development.
Well, so product development is very iterative. It seems like it's never done in a way until it's actually on the shelf. So what, you know, for us, it starts with ideation. So we have a design studio. It's like, all these whiteboards all around, and our designers will start iterating different forms and, you know, different solutions, feature benefits and things like that. It'll get into higher fidelity ideation through like Cintiqing, like it's basically like a tablet like deal where you can start designing and then you bring it into CAD. So we use SolidWorks. And then we start printing parts and testing parts. And we have 3D printers here and we just go straight through the process until we can actually have a product that's working.
So it's a pretty serious process. So Mark, jump in here too. Look, you have a lot of experience with your own products and selling them directly and manufacturing, sourcing them, and
you have basically I like a prototype, and a working prototype is the way that I call it. I'm much more on the business side of all of this. So I've licensed many products. I've taken hundreds of products to market. But the thing that fries my onions, and I don't know where some of these inventors got this idea, but they'll call me up and then they'll just start yelling out ideas. Like, how about a thing that spins around the house and comes and cuts your lawns and then lands in a basket? And I'm like, what the hell is that? You know what I mean? Like,
move ahead with that one? All
right. What's that?
You move ahead with that project?
No, I passed. But the bottom line is very simple. You just can't sit there and expect guys like us to take you seriously if you're just going to sit there and yell out a half a dozen ideas. That's what you do with your family. And then, of course, your family yells out, that's a fantastic idea. But the worst, and you know, when I speak at your events, Warren, I mean, the name of my keynote is, but my mother thinks it's a great idea. And, that's for you and your family to discuss. But once you've got it, I like an inventor with some skin in the game. And what I mean by that is going to a Trevor, spending some money, making a working prototype. That lets me know that you're serious. And once I know that you're serious, then I will pick it up and take a real look at it.
Let's talk about, we'll start with you, Mark, and then go back to Trevor, reverse, the odds for success. I've got a book on my desk here and it says gold mines are right around the corner and you can become a millionaire. And I saw a recent poll in Inventor's Digest that said 72% of all inventors think they're going to become a millionaire from their ideas. And yet I found in my experience that doesn't happen very often. In fact, under 1% of the time, which means a 99% failure rate. But I'll let you guys answer. Tell me about the odds for success and then tell me about the odds of success of throwing an idea up against the wall versus developing a product. What do you think?
Well, I have a funny saying. I go around and I say, I got to kiss 100 frogs to find my prince. So that's, that's the 1% that you just referred to. So people say, what do I do for a living? And I tell them I'm in the frog kissing game because you just got to keep doing it. And you meet a lot of people and the success is, 72% and all that other nonsense around the corner. And, they sell, it's almost similar to lottery. But the first thing that I suggest is you go and you do a knockout search, because I don't know about you, Trevor, but how many people come to you and it's been there, done that, bought the t-shirt, you've seen it already. It's just a little bit tweaked, but not tweaked enough that it's going to make a difference to solving that problem. So, the chances are, and that's why I started at the beginning saying how picky I was, because being this experienced over a period of about 30 to 35 years, I can kind of smell the difference between a hero and a zero. And that's what I try to, do. Do I bat 1,000? Babe Ruth didn't bat 1,000. Why would I bat 1,000? But I do my best job to take a look, calculate what I think the probability of success is, and then I roll. But most of the times I'm okay, but a lot of times I'm wrong as well.
But Trevor, you've had a great program for years where inventors could fill out an application with you and go through your litmus test, and you would evaluate them and give them a score and everything. So you've met a lot of inventors with a lot of products. What's the percentage of those things that actually make back a lot of money for the inventor? I mean, what are the odds here we're talking about?
It's speculative, right? I mean, this is, you're really entering a speculative world, and it the reality to the inventor is it's a long shot. And we're talking single digits for us in terms of when we're taking on products. We take single digit number of the evaluation. It depends on the month or the year in terms of just the batches of products that we get. But like, you know, like Mark, you know, we were kissing a lot of frogs as well. And then we also, like, of the ones that we take on, you know, again, we're not successful with 100%, not even close, you know? So it's like currently, so we have metrics at both companies. So Lambert Licensing and Enhanced sort of work on the licensing side together. It's a shared team, but so we have a metric and we call it engagement rate, meaning of all the products that we're currently representing, what percentage are in substantive discussions with licensees? And we always seek to achieve a 20% or higher. You know, right now we're at 37%, which is high for us. And in some ways, actually, the COVID-19 is helping. We're actually finding that the folks that are making the decisions tend to be a little bit more available right now to consider these things. That's one of the things we think might be the reasons. But it's also a batch of products we have. It's you know, that whole thing. But yeah, it's a low percentage, and it's really important that inventors know that. It's important that any company that works with inventors, that they soberly give them that information. That is the reality.
And so, you know, you're talking about percentage of companies that are interested, but I see things like I'll see a social media post about someone signed a licensing deal. You know, I've signed over 120 licensing deals, so I get it. But just because you sign a licensing deal doesn't mean the product's going to be successful at market, right?
And that's the reality too, is that you might have a license deal and nothing really comes to market. Nothing happens. You know, like the licensee might move forward, might start showing buyers, whatever, and it just languishes and really doesn't do much. Or you even get it into a retailer and there's really no resale because the product just didn't perform. And so for us at, you know, it's that 80-20 rule, right? Where 20% of your products are making you 80% of your royalties. And that's definitely the case for us. We have items that have done millions in royalties. We have. Not a lot. I mean, that's the reality, is that those are great deals.
You're a professional too, though.
And that's what we do, right? Yeah, absolutely.
You have a team of 20 people.
Right, absolutely. I've got a major infrastructure, you know, I got payroll, right? So we need to have those successes just to sustain. But the average inventor, you know, again, you might sell 50,000, if you get a license deal, it might sell 50,000 units, and that might be the end of the product. And, you know, that's maybe, you know, at a $20 product, at a $10 wholesale, just using rough numbers, at a 5%, that's like $25,000, you know? So it's like, I mean, so that's the reality. So this whole notion of like millions and millions, like when I'm, because it's like with our team at Enhanced Product Development, because we get hired by brand companies, we have our own products that we're developing and manufacturing, actually, which is kind of another part. We do some things that Mark does as well. But then we also have an inventor group. And so my sales team knows you may not say these things. You may not say millions. You can't even say that word. My team is not allowed to say it because it's a bunch of BS to do that, to just play on people's hopes.
And it's a great point. And Mark, just back to you, you know, people have a limited amount of money. Let's just say you have a new product idea and you say, I've got 10 grand or 15 grand to, you know, to spend. You know, what do they spend their money on? I mean, look, here are the options. They can spend it on patents. Obviously, there's early round patenting, like a provisional, which is inexpensive, you know, before they get serious. They can develop a working prototype. There's coaches out there that want to charge them, you know, and take, you know, without any guarantee of success at all. And then the odds are slim. So where would you suggest they put their, if they have 15 grand, where to put that, Mark? Where would you put it?
Well, first of all, I would put it towards protecting your item if you really want to put your skin in the game. And then secondly, I would put my money into a working prototype, because a guy like me is not going to look at it without a working prototype. I'm more of a licensee. I'm the guy that you want to license it to, because I've got the connections all over and I've got the money. And if I like it, I do it. One thing I want to say to Trevor is, like, it's easy to sell in to retail, but it's really hard to sell out. So, and Trevor's 100% right. And an old fart once told me that. And it's the truth. You can get it in and you can sell the hell out of it, but if the customer doesn't agree with you or you don't get that traction, you can license until the cows come home. You got a big bag of nothing. So, So I'll give you an example of an item that I just licensed and what I do to kind of, what do? I kind of take the deck and I make it more in my favor. It was an item, and I'm in the waterproof fire starter business and camping. So that's one of my categories of my products. So I'm always looking for things that fit that model because I've already got the fingers of distribution. I already got everything going. I don't have to get new reps. I don't have to do anything. So there was this, I went to an appearance in Boston. This guy came in, a pitch event, and he came in with this thing that threaded your fishing hook in 2 seconds and it snapped to your rod. It was an absolute no-brainer. He didn't want to run a company. He wanted to license. I looked at it. I said, well, it's the same demographic as my fire starter, so why don't I take a look? He had a prototype. He ran a couple of pieces domestically, and he's just a nice guy. The item looked like a grand slam to me. But so I took it on. I licensed it. But one of the things I did, instead of it just being the hooky, I went to a master licensor and said, hey, Realtree, would you allow me to put the Realtree name on this? So it's kind of like, I don't want to say double licensing, but I'm licensing it from them. And to Trevor's point, if it's a Realtree item, the chances of selling out are 10 times better than it's just like an off-handed hooky. So those are the things that I'm talking about. Those are the things that I think that people need to understand, that there's different ways to try to ensure your success on top of just licensing and trying to solve a point and going to my friend at Walmart and saying, you got to put this in the sporting goods section. The truth is yes, but they already have 1,000 feet of Realtree. So if it's an additional item in the Realtree section, now the license just went from a 1% chance of being successful to a 50% chance of being successful.
We're going to talk a little bit more, Mark, during the show about exactly that, which is finding the right company, the right brands and everything. But before we switch gears into that entirely, just Trevor, you know, I like you, you know, I always comb, you know, Kickstarter, Indiegogo, the crowdfunding platforms and so forth. And whenever I see some in Grommet and all that, I buy it. You know, I've got orders in for 30 products, you know, and the vast majority on the crowdfunding sites have not shipped. And I ordered some of these things a year ago, and I get these notes, I don't know if you get them too, all the time saying, well, we were just about ready, but this broke or that broke or this didn't work. To me, that's all about product development. I mean, these folks have raised money, you know, on the crowdfunding platforms, and now they're going back. And this is how difficult it is. They never hit their deadline, their ship deadlines, because this is how difficult it is to turn an idea, even when it's, you know, it developed in advance, into a fully functioning product. What's your, have you had similar experiences? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, you know, like you, I'm a backer of many items because I just love it. And I just love the spirit of the innovator, and they're creating these new items. But you're right. I mean, they put out these schedules as to when they're shipping to backers, and rarely do they hit it, very rarely. Now we also do crowdfunding, and so we have some items as well. And honestly, I'm the creator on two of them. And we just did a board game called Migration Mars, and we had about I think 3,000 backers. It was like 130 some thousand. It went really well. I'm so thankful, and we're actually on pace for a really quick one. But the other one we did, which is Vibroom, what would happen was we had to pivot to a lithium battery, which really added about 6 months of development for us, of components and back and forth with suppliers and things like that. And I actually have one sitting right here. I've got boxes and boxes of these things.
Where can you buy one of those?
That's shameless of me to bring that up, but so we're actually launching that one now. And yes, it's really important to have the product development team when you go into a crowdfund, so you know exactly how to handle it. You know, I know of people who have done crowdfunds and didn't even have quotes.
Like, well, you know, we all, of course, know the coolest cooler story with Ryan Grepper, who we know at GIA.
That poor guy.
It's just interesting to me that beyond the idea that you could throw an idea out there, that there's so much development work necessary. And then even when you get over to the factory and you start tooling, then you find out that they can't tool it, you know, and it's just one thing after the next.
Well, with Vibroom, I've been back and forth to the factory twice in the last 9 months. In fact, I was there in late December. So anyway, for during the COVID-19 situation.
And then to your point earlier, you really haven't had success till it gets on the shelf, people buy it and reorders. I mean, really, there's so many steps beyond getting your patent and actually signing a license.
I will say though, crowdfunding is a great way just as a market validation tool. I mean, certainly also just as far as getting some money, some dry powder to work with as far as going into tooling. But I mean, I have used the Vibroom story on Kickstarter to buyers at Walmart. We're now vendor to Walmart. We're now vendor to Target. We're now vendor, you know what I mean? It's like these, you know, Bed Bath and Beyond as well. So it's helpful. It's really
No, I didn't mean to. I love the model just like you do. I just meant that these things are ongoing. These challenges are ongoing. And sometimes Absolutely. You can have a product and geez, it can't even be manufactured. It's not even manufacturable at the end of the day. So, you know, the more information you have, the more ready you are, the easier it is to get to market.
Well, just because you can 3D print a part doesn't mean you can mold that part in mass. And so that's a very important.
That's right. And success is not defined by getting your patent issued or signing a license agreement. Success is by how much money you put in the bank. I mean, the real money, right? I mean, okay. So Trevor, let's pivot a little bit and we'll start with you and then come back to Mark. So we're talking about licensing today, and we know you guys have a lot more experience than just that, but from your experience, let's talk about good companies, finding the right companies where, Trevor, you've done it many, many times in many industries, especially if it's a new industry. How do you get started finding the right company to approach if you want to license your product?
Well, you know, the point of a license deal is that you might leverage this company's ability to distribute your product, right? That's the whole point of it. So you don't go to just some factory that makes things. Typically, you're looking for someone who either has a brand or brands, and especially in certain spaces, you know, just like Mark has his categories that he can just plug and play. So you want to find those, you know, those marks in whatever category it might be. So, you know, again, for us, we're looking like who can really distribute it in mass. And a lot of times, where do you look for that? Well, you look, where do you envision your product to sell? Is it on a certain planogram in Lowe's? Go to Lowe's, look at who are these companies who, you know, that are there. But yeah, you definitely want to find those companies that can distribute. And I think also it's great to be able to leverage the UIA and other people who know, because I mean, being in this business for 20 years, I mean, there are companies that are positioned to, you know, to sell your product, but you don't want to work with them. I mean, there's a lot of companies we do not pitch products to just because I don't trust them. They don't have, they're notorious for knocking products off or whatever. I mean, the whole point is that there's a certain level of trust that has to go both ways. So you want to find a trustworthy company and then one that has the ability to distribute.
So Mark, I'll let you pick up on that too, and then I'll come back with some specific questions. But what's been your experience licensing? How do you find good companies?
Well, I mean, I'm more of a grinder, but I do agree with Trevor in the fact that first you take the item and you kind of see what do you want to be when you grow up. So you look. And then you make those decisions, and then your vision takes you to let's call it a major retailer, like Trevor said. You go on the shelf, you see if it's a light bulb item, go to the light bulb section, go to the lighting section. Another thing that I do is I will look up the National Association of Electrical Distributors, something that's connected in there. And then I just start digging and digging and digging and digging. And then, you know, also to Trevor's point, like, do you want this to be an As Seen on TV item, or do you want it, or do you want it to be a retail item? Do you think it goes to distribution? Both. You have to make all of these decisions before you figure out who you want to approach. Because, again, like Trevor said, people will knock you off, and some certain people out there are notorious for it. And this show's not long enough to discuss that. So, you know, it's really a matter of the vision that you have for that product. And then what's the best way? Is it a B2B? Is it a B2C? I have certain products that we only do online, e-commerce. I have a company that I own that just does e-commerce platforms. We pick, pack, and ship. Sometimes, B2C, or sometimes we ship it to the warehouses and they do it for us. So those are big decisions that I'll ask an inventor and say, okay, what's the dream? What's the vision? What do you see here? I'll let them speak first, and then I'll try to interject with ways that I think it could be even bigger than they see. But
when you identify a company, Mark, what are you looking for from that company that gives you a signal that they might be a good company? Is it the website, or there things they say there? Is it the person you connect with? What gives you a feeling that it might be a good company if you're unfamiliar with them?
Well, number one, I want to see what their presence looks like in the store or online. So I'll take a look. I'll go on Amazon. I'll see what they're doing. We have certain ways to find out how much they're selling on Amazon, so I could see how much traction that category is getting. We do things like that. That's, you know, who's the biggest in the game first? Not biggest is always not best. Believe me, biggest is not always best. Give me a medium-sized company who wants to play, and I'll show you a deal. But it's not always, you just don't, if you have a lighting item, you just don't run to General Electric. First of all, there's walls and walls and walls and walls, unless you've got somebody on the inside. But, you know, a medium-sized company, and Trevor made a great point before, during the COVID-19, this has been an absolute bonanza for me, because everyone's available. People I would email, they'd get back to me in 2 days, they get back to me in 10 minutes. They are sitting around eating chips on the couch.
So Trevor, I do want to get into inventor clubs and trade shows, but can I ask you the same question as Mark too? When and you've approached a lot of companies, you have a lot of success and history with that. What are you looking for in a company? Because certain companies don't have open innovation programs, certain do, right? I mean,
there are companies that have a culture built in of opening, you know, their doors to inventors and open innovation platforms. You know, I mean, perfect example, Warren, is, you know, Lifetime Brands and TTI, companies that you've built out whole open innovation platforms for. So they're obviously looking. It does help. I mean, you could go to a website and they could even have an inventors tab, meaning that they are open to these things. And so, you know, that tells you that, right? And, you know, to that point, to what Mark said, a lot of times the biggest company isn't the best one for licensing. And oftentimes it's usually the case, because the bigger the company, the more commonplace it is for them to just buy out a company. They just buy a company if they wanted a product, rather than why would they license? You know, it's so these medium-sized companies tend to be really fertile ground for inventors.
You know, a little goofy thing I'll throw in here, besides going to the website and so forth, is especially in industries I've never, you know, had any experience with before, sometimes you can call these big companies and just find out from the switchboard operator if they even have an open innovation department or anyone's assigned to it. If they don't have a clue what you're talking about, it's pretty good chance that they haven't done a lot of licensing. So it's just one fun place to start, but that's just a little tidbit. But Trevor, yeah. I wanted to continue on with that. And you're a veteran of many trade shows. Obviously you and I have walked many of them together. Tell me about trade shows and how inventors can use that. I mean, once they get back going again, of course.
Yeah. You know, if we had this 3 months ago, this Zoom, I would have said trade shows, you gotta go. It's going to be interesting to see what trade shows look like in the future. Honestly, I think it's a lot of uncertainty. It seems to me that you have to have something like this. And so my hope is it will continue, because it's pretty central to our business. But speaking of trade shows, I've had great success in making connections, developing relationships. And, you know, it's, you know, like Houseware Show, which you and I, and you've been longer than I, for me, it's been almost 20 years now of going to the Houseware Show. Every time I go, it seems like this great reunion. Yeah. So many people, you know, and you just have to make sure that you see everybody and you might have products for them. And so trade shows are great. And, you know, if you have a rep or someone like us, you know, you can leverage some of those relationships. But if not, still go professionally, introduce yourself. Generally, I say don't call yourself an inventor. That's something that I've, again, that's just my opinion. I think that inventor, that connotation of an inventor tends to work, cut against you a little bit. If you call yourself a product developer or a patent owner, you know, almost anything other than inventor, I think you get a better response. But trade shows are great. And, you know, there's a lot of strategies there that we can speak of on trade shows.
I agree with you. Trade shows, it'll be interesting to see how they come out of the virus, because some of the big companies may want to save a few bucks and and not do them in the future. But as far as the inventor areas and the inventor pavilions, obviously you've been involved with UIA and that, pitch panels, educational series, but also shows like, some of the bigger trade shows that even have, what's the Eureka Park, and all that.
CES, yep.
Yes, and so forth. Talk about how inventors, even if you don't show your product there or have a booth, how they can take advantage of some of the educational pursuits of trade shows, maybe.
I mean, trade shows are so valuable for inventors. I mean, and I wouldn't recommend that they have a booth, quite frankly. I mean, like you said, there are so many different educational series that are for inventors. The UI obviously supports some of them, but no matter what the show, there's so much you can learn in various seminars, but also just going in and going in a more proactive or active role, going to the company that you think might be the fit. That's rather than waiting for somebody to come to your booth and hoping that they're going to license it, you can actually, if you do it proper, you can actually go to the company and find out who to speak to and pitch it.
So Mark, you're a veteran of the hardware show. You've been to the UIA Inventor Booth Pavilion. I think we had 175 booths last year, biggest booth pavilion now for inventors in the country. You've spoken there, you've been on panels. Tell us your experience with, for instance, at the hardware show and the booth area there.
I happen to, I'll give you a shameless plug to UIA because I love it. I love trade shows. I like to look into the whites of people's eyes. I mean, that's just the kind of guy I am. And everybody's got big muscles behind the emails and all that stuff. So, I mean, when I walk your show, Warren, I don't walk it once. I probably walk it close to four times. I walk it over a course of 2 or 3 days and I continue to walk it. I just think it's so important because, and I always say this and I'll keep it clean, but it's 50% inventor and 50% invention, because it gives me a real sense, because I got a good gut on me. I can see if the inventor is as loony as a fruitcake, and then I can run away. Because normally the invention could be great, but if the person's nuts, I don't have time for it. I'm sure Trevor and yourself, I'm sure none of us have time
for it. That's a really good point. So you evaluate both the product and the person.
Oh yeah, it's 50-50 for me. I could see an unbelievable item, but I am not going to put up, I can't dance at every wedding. And we started off, Trevor and I both said we're very, very picky. And that's part of my process. I can't speak for Trevor, but I don't have the wherewithal. But to get back to the trade show, and I'll give you actual specifics. I walk into these booths, every single one of them. I want to hear what they have to say. I want to see the item. I just want to get involved. I've seen people in the aisle in your pavilion. I've run into Phil Swift from Flex Seal. If you've got an item that works for that guy and he jumps on it, what's the chances of you emailing him and getting some sort of response versus him wandering into your booth? I think the opportunities are so much bigger when you do a trade show. And I'm really sad in the fact that, they've closed down, and I really hope to God that they come back, because some of my best deals ever in my history have been done in the aisle of a trade show. Awesome. No bullshit.
That's awesome. Well, I will tell you what, that even if some of the big companies decide they can live without a trade show, they're always still going to send people there. Like one of the companies I worked with, TTI, the Power Tool Group, didn't show at the hardware show, but their management was always there, So they'll still come through the inventor pavilions, which is kind of cool. So I'll just throw that out there. But Mark, let me shift a little bit too. And you're a veteran of going out on the road and talking to inventor clubs around the country. Talk a little bit about inventor clubs and how that might be a platform for people locally to get involved and learn.
I am a humongous fan of inventor clubs. Some of the clubs welcome you with such open arms. It's not even funny. It's they invent these items, they pitch to each other. But when I give them an opportunity to pitch and the money's real, it's not like playing Monopoly anymore. Now they have a real shot that they can take the item somewhere. And like I said, I'm not shitting on inventor clubs. I love them. I think they're amazing. But the ability to come in and then pitch, and I go all over the place. I mean, Minneapolis and Washington, D.C. and all of these different clubs. I really appreciate it. And I think they really appreciate me. So I've got nothing but kudos for these clubs. I love them.
And I think the people that run them are terrific. And a lot of them are, most of them are nonprofits, 501c3. And by the way, folks, it's important when you're checking things out, when you're getting information stuff, that who are the nonprofits, who are the real true 501c3s that are giving you education materials, and who has organizations that are fronts for profit companies. But hey, Carmine, I will let you jump in, brother, or if you're ready. I'm sure a few questions have come in, and I'm kind of hogging these guys. So do you have a question?
What happened? Oh, sorry, I was eating lunch. I didn't even know what was happening over here. No, we're getting some awesome interaction on our YouTube channel. A lot of good questions. And, you know, real quick, I know a real quick one for Trevor. He'll answer real quick. Trevor, we had a question come in. You used to be Lambert and Lambert. You changed the name. Why?
Oh, yeah. So Lambert, everyone kept thinking we were attorneys. Everybody did. And we're not. So just disclaimer, we're not attorneys. Yeah. And so we thought we didn't want to lose Lambert and like just change a name, kind of like some of these other companies do. So we changed it to Lambert License, just because it was more clear.
Yeah. And I was going to answer on, but I figured you might want to.
Well, we didn't change the website either. So, you know, Lambert Invent. I mean, we just, you know. So.
Very cool. Hey, Mark, a question came in for you. Do you sign an NDA?
Sure. I'll sign an NDA any day, anyway. But one of the things I want to, I always say in my thing, if somebody's not willing to sign an NDA, run for the hills. But let me put a little asterisk under there. You have to tell me what the category is. Yeah. I'm not going to sign a blanket NDA and then all of a sudden you get to tie me up until kingdom come. That's what these idiots do. And that's not for me. So the short answer is yes, of course I will, because my intentions are nothing but pure and I want to do good business. But you have to tell me. I don't play charades. You can't tell me it's a movie. It sounds like all this other bullshit. I just need to know at least what the category is and a general description of the item, and I'm happy to sign one.
And let me jump in there too. I mean, you know, it's people should understand, because I process a lot of NDAs, you know, many thousands I process. Companies typically like to use their own NDA because they sign so many of them that they don't want to have an attorney review every one. So that's not necessarily a bad thing if a company wants you to sign their NDA. But what you do need to do is look at it carefully and make sure it's fair. I've seen some very unfair NDAs. And by the way, an NDA is a good indication if it's unfair or it's heavily in the company's favor, that they might not be the company that you know is going to work out with in the long term. Just a little inside tip there. So.
Oh, cool. Cool. Man, we had so many questions. I'm trying to pick the top ones. We're going to have to get back to some of these characters. So for each of you guys, what is one of your top products that you've had hits with? Mark, you want to go first?
You want me to go first?
Yeah, go ahead, Mark.
Sure. On season two of All American Makers, we had a UV glue that cures in 4 seconds. It's called Bondic. And we continue to this day to absolutely crush it. I would consider that one of my bigger successes. Go on Amazon and buy the shit out of it.
Hey, Mark, real quick before we go to Trevor, on All American Makers, which I love the show, what would you do if somebody said this thing is indestructible?
That was my favorite, because we would have an 18 wheeler waiting outside and we would run it over. Like, that was my favorite. I used to elbow with my co-host when they would come in and go, this thing is indestructible, because very few things are indestructible. And he's a science guy, a 3D printer guy from PrinterBot. And he enjoyed running things over with the car, because that was his favorite.
Yeah. You know? I asked because I remember the show, and I'd see you guys look at each other, and I just started laughing to think.
I wasn't even the science guy, and I started laughing because I wasn't even around for the testing. Those two guys would go test it. They'd come back to the boardroom and tell me what happened. But as soon as they would say something stupid like that, I was just like, hey, have at it, man. Enjoy yourself.
You know what, Carmen? That was a great show. And just to give Mark another shameless plug, he was the star of Home Shopping Network's American Dreams. And that was with Damon John and a whole crew of superstars there. Mark used to bring in twice as many products as the rest of them combined. So,
yeah, no doubt.
Well, because I'm in that game full time. I'm in that exact game. So bringing 10 items at a time wasn't really a lot, because, you know, I have the platform markportney.com. It's Mark with a C, and you can submit your invention. And I get probably between 10 and 20 a week from all over the world. So and then obviously, as Trevor mentioned before, you got to kiss all those frogs and get your 1 out of 100. But at least they submit.
And you know, Mark has to go out in disguise just to go out to dinner.
Please give me a break.
He's huge.
Give me a break. Yeah, huge. My stomach's huge. That's what's huge.
Trevor, I'll get to you. What's one of your top products, my friend?
A couple of them. I have products all over here. So yeah. This one, True Touch Pet Glove. This one has done really well the last 3 or 4 years. It's still in most major retail. Knocked Off. Millions of times over on Amazon, sadly. And then Hover Cover, which is like a splatter cover for your microwave that actually just adheres to the inside of the ceiling of your microwave, so you just grab it. Both of those have been millions of units sold.
Wow. So I have seen those. Those are awesome products.
Hey, Trevor, you're not a success until you get knocked off.
Oh my God. Yeah. I'm very involved with the Alibaba intellectual property protection process. Which is actually a good thing, is Alibaba is pretty good about that, by the way, these automatic takedowns. Once you get all of your IP registered, you know, because we have like for Vibroom, for instance, we already have knockoffs. Wow. We haven't even sent it to our backers yet. We already have knockoffs. So it's anyway, it's.
But since the title of the show is licensing.
Sorry.
Tell all our big hits.
Sorry.
No. Seriously. But it does make sense in licensing, right, Trevor, that if you license with a bigger entity and they have a legal department, they can fight some of those legal battles for you, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's a game of whack-a-mole online. And, you know, I'm not the only one who uses that terminology, too, because you knock one and another one comes up, and it's just, you just got to stay on top of it. It's nice to be able to leverage the legal department of a larger company that's willing to fight and protect your rights for you.
I took an item on HSN once. We weren't even off air. It was a 12-minute segment. We weren't even off air, and there were 30 knockoffs on Alibaba. I mean, I couldn't even get to the goddamn green room, and we were knocked off 30 times.
Yeah.
It was unbelievable.
All right, now you know it's the real Mark Portney, if you ever see him probably. He's not cursed.
But it's a rich problem, right? I mean, this is what happens when you hit it success. You know what I mean? It's just something that it's one of those things. Like every inventor would be happy to have this problem. It means that you've sold a lot of units.
But Trevor, like a lot of, in my experiences, you know, when the legal department gets involved with signing a licensing agreement, they're going to review your intellectual property and they're going to make an assessment on it. And they're also going to make a decision whether, you know, obviously with their brands and their marketplace strength and all that, but also the patents that they can protect it, you know? And once you get into that safe haven, they can do a better job than you can.
And to that point, the larger the company, the more strict they are when they go dissect your claims and your patent. I mean, we were in late stage discussions with like Colgate-Palmolive not too long ago, and they're like, you know, they weren't super in love with the patents that our client had. So, I mean, those things fall apart, whereas a medium-sized company might be fine with that risk, you know, so.
Anyway. That's another thing you can use, folks, when you're evaluating, you know, the company, how they intellectual property and whether they'll be supportive of you. Sorry, Carmine, I'll let you, it's your show. You take over, man.
He always says that, guys.
Yeah.
Right at the end.
Hey, Trevor, real quick, going back to the two products that you showed, what is the percentage of licensing a product, bringing it into your company? And then you have some really smart people. So the products, do you develop more products than you license, or you license more products than you develop?
So we have layers to our business that enhance, right? So a lot of people just come and they just want us to develop their product. And then we have inventors that come to us. I'd say the inventor portion of our business, we have like a design for licensing strategy. Like briefly, we usually tell people to get it into CAD, get some renderings going, so it looks like it's complete, get some feedback, and then invest into prototyping at that point. And so that percentage of our whole is probably 65, 70% of our business. And so then we have about 10, 15%. Well, the other amount really just, sometimes it's a brand that comes in and we have a big project typically, or a lot of it's our own stuff. So we have in our pipeline right now, quite a few of our own items that we're developing as well. Some that are like earmarked to go crowdfund and then to market or licensing or whatever it might be. We have some clients now, inventors that are also utilizing us for the crowdfunding as well. So it's, you know, we're kind of like I said, there's just a lot of layers to our business. We're not really one thing necessarily. We've been evolving over these last 10 years. So.
Wow. Awesome. And Mark, for you, I know you do most, you mostly bring products into the company, right?
Yeah, no, I have a little bit of a different model. I do a lot of submissions based upon being out there in the public eye a little more. I get a ton of international stuff because they renamed the show Invent It Rich, and there is so many reruns that, and I can always tell where they show it. So I'll get 20 submissions from Prague overnight, and I just know they've shown it, you know, in Prague. If I get one more COVID-19 submission, I'm gonna choke on it. Oh my God, dude, I can't. It's unbelievable. But you know, so the short answer is, yeah, I get a lot of submissions, and you know, through trade shows, through people recommendations, they'll recommend people to me. So there's no shortage of opportunities.
Why do the marketers always change the name of the show to, you know, Become Rich or something like that? You know, it's
just... because I think, I mean, I don't know this for a fact, but I don't think they wanted the name American in it. That's really what I can make. So Invent It Rich is, of course, pandering to what we talked about at the beginning, that all the inventors think that they're sitting on $1 million idea like lottery. And so Invent It Rich, and everybody's, you know, it's dubbed. I mean, having other languages dubbed over me is pretty amusing.
Cut all the same BS around the world. That's good to know.
Yeah, I just want to see the lady's face who's trying to do all the cursing that I'm saying and trying to translate it. But
yeah, I watched Mark's show from Italy. All I hear was beep, 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 beep.
I was such a good boy on that show.
We kind of covered, Trevor, we kind of covered, you know, how important a patent is to you if you're going to license a product. You kind of talked a little bit about that. Is it better to bring you a more functional prototype product without a patent and use that money, as we talked about, to have a good prototype working functional than for somebody to say, hey, I got this great patent and, you know, and here's the drawing out of a napkin, right?
Yeah, I mean, if you have intellectual property, I like the product. And so we have, it's always been our sort of policy at Lambert Licensing is if someone's in manufacturing, we don't require that they go through the evaluation process. We're like, just, you know, if we send us as much as you can, we might have some questions and we want to talk. And so we sort of bypass it. So again, that just shows all of the work that's gone into it. So, I mean, you earn a seat at the table at that point when you've put that investment in.
Carmine, let me jump in on the other side with these guys too on that one too, since I did so much.
And I
know there was a podcast last week with the president of Lifetime Brands, and Dan's a very close friend of mine, and we do a lot of, you know, he started building the program. He is the president now, so he's less involved today than he was, you know, years ago when we first got the program started 14 years ago. There were some things said about, you know, intellectual property and building prototypes and so forth. I can just assure people, I want to give a very direct message to everybody who's listening here, that building prototypes and filing intellectual property is critical. The question came up, you know, can you design it on a napkin? Well, sure. Lifetime Brands has 65 people in the product development department, and they have 3D printers and a whole floor of stuff that can go on. They could take a napkin and they can develop it. If Dan Siegel is at dinner and gets an idea and wants to send it over to the department, you know, the product development department, they can build the thing the next day. But that's not how it happens for inventors. And I want to make sure that that's, if anybody wants to offline, email me, www.tuttle@yahoo.com. I'll fill you in on the true story. I've done, you know, I think over 120 licensing agreements, not one. I want to repeat this because we're going to, you know, we have a lot of fun in this industry, but I want to give facts to people, not marketing BS. We've never done one on off a napkin. Of all the products I've ever licensed, every one of them has had a utility patent. Now, we will engage in negotiations if you have a PPA, you know, a 12-month PPA, but you need to convert it to a non-provisional. This is a legal standard, okay? So it has to be much more than an idea. I've signed, I think, two licensing deals that had design patents. The rest have all had utility patents. So, and by the way, if it is, if you have a design patent, it's a lower royalty. And so the value of the patent matters too, on top of even getting the licensing deal. And by the way, it's the same with TTI, and it's the same with, you know, the other companies I help. So I want to separate, it's, we all love to have conversations and sit in the bar and say, oh yeah, we could do this. Yeah, we're capable of doing it, but that's not reality. It's not how it really works. And you really need to do your homework, inventors. Really spend your money wisely, put in the right efforts, and not, you know, just go along the marketing lines that, oh yeah, you can take an idea, throw it out there. Now, are there certain industries that maybe be a little looser? For sure. But at the end of the day, a lot of industries and most big companies, you know, want the IP and the prototype. So sorry, I just wanted to get that into our audience.
Cool. So real quick, I only got a couple minutes left. Trevor and Mark, I'll throw this to them. Question came up a couple times. What category do you think is best to try to license a product in, or what type of product? Trevor, if you want to go first.
Well, I mean, I can tell you the categories that we focus on anyway. I mean, we're in consumer markets, right? So that's kind of been our main thing. So from pet items, housewares items, that's where I've really built my Rolodex up of companies that we're in discussions with, or people that, oh, hey, I can look at some and say, that's perfect for such and such company. You know, that's a lot, that goes on a lot of our calculus when we're looking at items and evaluating them is who might be the licensee in the end. You know, is broadly speaking, I'm most attracted to items that provide a smart solution to a real problem. Like to me, like, so that's very broad, but I don't care what it is, what category, I'm more interested in that. I hate Chatsky stuff. Like it just doesn't get, you know, move my needle at all. Mm. And usually I can't get a licensee excited about something that's Chatsky. I that's just me. And that's why I don't do particularly a lot of toy. We have toy and we just launched a board game, but the board game is like really a thoughtfully designed board game. But that's me, and I'll let Mark kind of speak.
Yeah. Sorry. Oh, that makes sense.
No, well, Carmine, you know me very well. We talk almost every week, but I'm a mass item guy. If you appeal to the masses, you eat with the classes, and it's that simple. If you got a caviar holder, I don't give a shit about it because you're selling to the 1%. That's not me. Enjoy it. There's guys out there that sell to the 1%. I also love consumables because once you sell them something and then they need refills, i.e. the Bondic or whatever, we sell as many refills as we sell product. So those are kind of the things that I do. I love the camping and survival area because now with the COVID and all this, and I'm not trying to profit off of the COVID, so don't send me some shit ass emails. You know, preppers became super preppers. People that were on the bubble became preppers. So now with all this product that we have, waterproof fire starters with a 30-year shelf life, it makes sense. So those are the kind of items, camping, survival, all of this thing. So to me, that's a growing category for that reason. Baby boomers. I don't want to talk for Trevor. He looks young to me. But the rest of us are baby boomers. And what is it? It's the biggest demographic on the planet right now. And what are we all going to start doing? We're all going to start getting old. We're going to start shitting in our pants. So we need to do things that we need to start looking at things that appeal to that demographic. So I would want to be an adult diaper company coming up. But those are the type of things that I look at and analyze. And to Trevor's point, I don't like tchotchka items either. I like consumable, mass market killer items. That's what I look for.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Man, that hour went quick, huh, Carmen?
Yeah, it did. What about contact info for these guys?
Hey, yeah. Trevor, can you give your email? And then Mark?
Yeah. Sure. First name, Trevor at lambertinvent.com.
I'm mark.portney at gmail.com or markportney.com. You can submit an invention. You can ask me silly questions. You can yell at me. You can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
Or just reach out to us at the UIA and we'll connect you with these guys. And And again, next week, Carmine, we've got coming up two amazing attorneys, Jim Patterson, who's chair of the National Pro Bono Patent Commission and one of the great attorneys in America, and Andrea Hens Evans, who was a patent examiner herself for many, many years, has a very well-established business and really an expert also on trademarks and copyrights. So next week, same time, same station, is going to be another amazing week, another show.
It's awesome. It's awesome. And I want everybody on YouTube or listeners, if we did not get to your questions, we ran out of time. I guarantee if you email or connect with these guys, they will get back to you. I know Mark and Trevor both build their pride on getting back to whoever contacts them. So please, if you need to, get in touch with myself or Warren. But if you want to talk to these guys directly, they just gave you their contact info. Go ahead and reach out to them. If you have a product, obviously reach out to them. And that's why we're here. So this has been a great show. I want to thank Mark Portney, Trevor Lambert for coming on today and giving us the inside view of licensing.
Thanks, guys.
And for Warren Tuttle and for myself, Carmen Danisco, we thank you for listening. And we will catch you next week. As Warren said, same times, same channel. You all take care and we'll see you soon.